So this week, I don't know about for you, it sounds like some of you have had a pretty exciting week. Not exactly the excitement you would have liked. Let me add another prayer. Heavenly Father, I just ask for your spirit. We ask for your spirit of wisdom. We ask for your spirit of discernment. We ask for your presence to be upon us. I just ask for grace. That your grace would fill me, and that these words would be seasoned with your grace, and your spirit would speak to the hearts of your children and me. Amen. Amen. So the title of this text, with all my exciting week as it was, I want to tell you my most exciting class. My most exciting class is my world history class, last class of the day. You know, the time of trouble comes right before Jesus comes. So the very last one of my day, right before I get off, is my world history class. And they're delightful, except when I actually want to teach something. And I do enjoy them. And I learned so much. And then I have another delightful class, which Terrence is in. There's Terrence in the background. Now, I'm going to give Terrence his props today, because I don't want to embarrass him when we're in school. But I really appreciate Terrence. You know, Terrence, you know, you all come to, you love having some Bible class once a week. Well, they have it every day. And they have it every day with me. And so sometimes they're just, no one participates. And it's really hard. And so I appreciate Terrence because he'll speak. And it's challenging, you know. I have not had to teach a Bible class every single day. And I have to be interested, they have to be interested, and God's got to be busy every day. And sometimes, you know, we're all tired. And sometimes it's just not that exciting. Sometimes it's work, you know. And I just really appreciate Terrence because he searches in his word on his phone, and he, like, participates. And I just appreciate it. It makes me feel so much better. I'm like, oh, somebody, you know. And him and another student, Alec, does as well. But I really appreciate him, you know. And so, you know, and Teresa and George, good job. Good job. You know, I'm truly blessed. You know, it's good. I mean, even as a teacher, it's good to have a friend in the class, right? So we've been studying the Beatitudes. And we're like on the second week. And you're thinking, how could you possibly spend the second week? Well, I have this theory. It's not really a theory. But most of us, we don't learn this way. But if you want to understand the Bible, as Christians, not Jews, make a distinction. We cannot understand it if we do not understand who Jesus is. And I found it really instructive that in the first recorded sermon, right after he goes through his testing time, the first sermon he gives is the Beatitudes. And then as I was studying it myself, because I study it myself before I give it to the students, I realized he's talking about his own qualities. The qualities that he remembers from heaven, that heaven is like. He's talking about his Father's characteristics. And I just felt like I want to spend some time, because we were supposed to be studying Revelation. And I just felt like, how are we going to understand Revelation when we seem to be struggling on some basics? You know, including myself. And I said, so let's spend some time on the Beatitudes. Let's just talk about Jesus. And how do we see Jesus moving and working? And then how do we apply that to our lives? And there's a principle of biblical interpretation that Christians follow that's very distinctive from Jews. The Jews use the law to understand their text. And they compare it to the law. Okay, they compare it to the writings of Moses. They compare it specifically to the Ten Commandments. And then from there, they extrapolate or they apply it. Okay? They also look at their teachers, what their teachers have expounded on the law. They look at Moses. They compare the life of Moses to their own lives. They compare the life of Sarah. They compare all these different mothers and fathers of the old, what we call the Old Testament or the Hebrew Scriptures, and then they apply them to their own lives and see how can we represent those same qualities. Now, we do that too as Christians. We look at Moses, I mean, Paul, when you look at Paul's writings in Romans, for example, he does exactly this. He looks at Moses' life. He talks about the faithful and what they, he talks about Abraham, the father of the faithful, right? And he says, what then in chapter, Romans chapter 4, he says, what then, verse 1, what then shall we say that Abraham, our father, has found according to the flesh? For if Abraham was justified by the works, he was something to boast about, but not before God. For what does the scripture say? Abraham believed God, and it was accounted to him for righteousness. I'm going to come back there later. But notice he goes straight to Abraham. He's using Abraham as the example. Why? I don't know why he's using Abraham, but this is a tradition the Jews have. But who is our example? And Jesus is our example. If you look at John, I'm doing the sermon a little bit out of order, but apparently that's the way it's just going to go. If you look at John chapter, towards the end, let's see, John chapter 10. This is much more of a study than a sermon. And John chapter 10 is our text, 10, 7 through 9, and he says, then Jesus said to them again, most assuredly I say to you, I am the door of the sheep. All who ever came before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not hear them. I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved, and he will go in and out and find pasture. Then if you skip down and you go to verse 11, he says, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd gives his life for the sheep. Then go down to 14, and he says, I am the good shepherd, and I know my sheep, and am known by my own. Okay, then he goes to 15, and he says, as the Father knows me, even so I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. Then he goes into verse 18, and he says, no one takes it from me, but I lay it down, talking about his life, of myself, and I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it again. This command I have received from my Father. Let's look at this. Jesus is setting up a new, you might say a new paradigm, a new way of looking at the scripture. He says, and this is what's really interesting to me, he compares everybody who came before him, Abraham, Moses, Joshua, Jacob, all of them, he says they were hirelings. And you know what? They all, basically saying they all messed up. And he says, everybody came before me with thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not hear them. Did the children of Israel listen to Moses? No. They didn't decide to listen to him until after he was dead. Okay. They killed the prophets. They stoned the prophets. And God says, people, you are my people. You are my sheep. That's what God calls Israel, okay? And Jesus says, everybody before me, thieves and robbers and hirelings. The sheep didn't hear him, but he says, I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved and will go in and out and find pasture. Why is he saying this? He says, I'm the good shepherd. He's saying, what does the shepherd do? He guides the sheep. If we go later on in this chapter, he's in verse 27, he says, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. He's going to guide. Think Psalms 23. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. That's a picture of a shepherd. David was a shepherd. And here Jesus is saying, I am your guide. I am your example. Follow me. Hear my voice. Hear the words that I speak. Look at my life. Where I went, there you go. Okay? And that's what he's breaking it down. And he's saying, and you can trust me to take you to green pastures and to still waters. You can trust me. Look at what I've done. Look at my words. You can trust me. I notice in verse, I like this one, in verse 15, it says, in same chapter, chapter 10, verse 15, he says, as the Father knows me, even so I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. Notice he doesn't say, I love the sheep. He doesn't say, I care about the sheep. He doesn't say, I like the sheep. He says, I die for the sheep. He doesn't even use regular language. He's saying, I give up everything I have for you. The strongest language he can possibly show to show the depth of his concern and caring, self-sacrifice for his children, his people, you and I. He says, I lay down my life. And he says, I give it up. I choose to give it up. And we're like, wow. I mean, for me, I was like, wow. That's why we hear his voice and we believe him. Who in our lives? Now, you know, there's the mother who she sees a car coming and she throws her kid out of the way and she gets hit. Okay? She chooses because she loves her child. Or the father, right? You know, he has to make a choice. And so he puts the life jacket on his own child and he drowns. We hear about these stories, traumatic. But the one thing about them is they have to give up their life and they don't come back. But Jesus says, I am the one who can give it up for you and who can still walk with you afterwards, because he has that power. So he can be trusted to love and to protect completely. And he says this, because we have to understand this, to understand scripture. We will get lost and twisted all up. And this is why, you know, we ask, why are there all these denominations? Why are there all of these people? Why are the Muslims who believe in God, why do they have terrorists? Why do Christians who believe in God go around telling other Muslims that they're going to go straight to the depths of hell, and telling gays and lesbians and all these other human beings that Jesus made that they're all going straight to hell in a handbasket? And then talk about Jesus loves in another breath. Because they haven't learned to understand the scriptures, because they do not know Jesus. They know how to read, but they don't know Jesus. Okay? Now, Jesus, in many times, he says, hearing you hear you. What does he say? You have ears, but you can't hear. You have eyes, but you can't see. You read the scriptures because in them you think you have eternal life, but the scriptures testify of me. You can read, but you can't understand. You know the words, but they don't mean anything to you. Okay, we've all had that experience. We read something, and we're like, what just happened? I have no idea what it says. And this is what Jesus is saying. He's saying, and then he goes, and I'm going to take you to the end, and he says, in 10:25, he says, he says, I told you and you do not believe. The works that I do in my Father's name, they bear witness of me. He says, look at my life. Okay, these are the principles. You want to understand scripture? You must. Everything that you read in the scripture, you add it and you put it next to the life of Christ. Okay? You've got to put it next to the life of Christ, and then you can figure out how to apply it. And if it doesn't match the life of Christ, that means you don't understand something. And you need to put that text down. You need to just say, I don't get this text. Let me go back to the life of Christ. Okay? Now, he says, look at the works that he does. Then if you go down to verse 38, he says, this is what their problem is. He's talking to the Pharisees and Sadducees. He says, but if I do He says, if I do not do the works of my Father, do not believe me. But if I do, though you do not believe me, believe the works, that you may know and believe that the Father is in me and I in him. Okay? He says, keep saying, look at my life. Look at my life. Okay? Now let's go to John chapter 13, verses 14 through 15. Jesus is washing the disciples' feet. And he says, you call me teacher and Lord, and you say, well, for so I am. If I then, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. Okay? For I have given you an example that you should do as I have done. His life is a walking example. We call, in the Bible, they call it a testimony. In court, you give your testimony. You are a witness. But your witness isn't just your witness. You're a witness because you speak words. But your words tell a story about what happened. Your life is that story. Okay? Now, tell your story, Jesus. And the disciples really struggled with this because they were reading scriptures. The Pharisees and the Sadducees were really struggling with this. They were reading scriptures, and you can find these scriptures yourself. And they quote scriptures, and one right after he raises Lazarus from the dead, they're like, dude, they come back and they say he raised this guy from the dead. And the Pharisees and Sadducees, come on, look, does any prophet come from Galilee? Does any prophet come from Nazareth? No prophets ever come from there. By the way, they were wrong. There is another prophet that has come from there. But notice, they were reading their scripture. They just were wrong. And these dudes had memorized it. So that means, obviously, they hadn't memorized some of this stuff. Their recall was not so great. There's a conversation that's recorded where it says, but who's going to do greater miracles than these, greater works than these? He'll give sight to the blind. And they're left with nothing to say except it must be by the power of Beelzebub. You got to pause on that. Okay, because when you start calling the work of the Holy Spirit the work of the devil, you're on dangerous ground. Because what are you doing? You're judging. And when you start judging, you're thinking that you no longer have any sin. There's no way you could possibly be wrong. Well, and we all know that our righteousness is filthy rags, so we have to be real, real careful. Okay. And if we look and we go back to the life of Christ, we know that we have stepped away from his footsteps. Because we know when the woman was caught in adultery, caught in the act of sin itself, Jesus didn't judge her. He said, he looked at her. He said, where are your accusers? Where are they? And she's like, there's nobody here. And he says, well, then neither do I accuse you. Go and sin no more. He empowered her and said, goodbye. I love it. He didn't even say goodbye, but he empowered her to get up. I imagine he helped her up, maybe gave her his jacket, because if she was caught in the very act, she probably didn't have any clothes on. Covered her up, maybe gave her a hug. You know, I bet she probably had some friends somewhere who were scared to death. And then she went on her way, knowing that somebody had her back. But Jesus didn't judge her. I love that. And instead, that's what we see in the life of Christ. Washing people's feet, comforting, encouraging. When we look at scriptures, especially when we look at scriptures when we're angry, how are we comparing it to the life of Christ? Some scriptures are angry. And they tell us that it's okay to have feelings of anger and frustration. It's okay to be human, okay? It's okay to be mad. It's okay to feel things. But feel things and give them to God. Acknowledge your feelings. Even God has emotions. He gets angry. righteous anger. He gets jealous because he doesn't want us worshiping other gods that can do nothing for us, and we injure ourselves. So he loves us. He lays down his life for us. So we look at the life of Jesus to interpret scriptures, compare, and you say, how do I look at the life? Well, just look at what he did, and then read your text and think about what you're going to do based on what you read. So if you read a text, let's look at an example. What, does anybody have a text that they're struggling with, maybe? I mean, I can find a few crazy ones, but anybody got any texts that maybe they struggle with? You know, here's, let's see. David has some good ones where he kind of goes off. Let me see. I was looking for one, but you know, there's one. Let's look at the story in the Old Testament. The Israelites are coming. The story of Saul. This is a good one in Samuel. Saul is king. He's been anointed king, and God tells him to go and kill all men, women, children, animals, oxen, the king, I want to call him an Amorite, but I don't think he's an Amorite. And he tells him to kill them all, kill the whole village. The guy shows up again in Esther. One of his descendants shows up again in Esther. And Saul doesn't do it. Saul's like, look, we saved the best for sacrifice. We saved the king. And the story goes on and says how the king is so happy because he thinks he's not going to die. And Samuel looks at Saul and says, you didn't trust the word of the Lord. And Samuel goes and kills the king, cuts him up. The story says he cuts him up. What do you do with that story and compare that to Jesus who hangs on a cross? You have a situation in your life. You have an enemy who has been an enemy, has hurt people. You see him hurting you, and now's your chance. He's been doing wrong to people at your job. He's got people that you know who are being fired because of this person. He's just a horrible person. He should be off somewhere, you know? Maybe you're really angry with him because you're about to get fired too. You've seen your friends be fired and all these things. What do? You just read the story about Saul. And God told him to eliminate his enemies completely. Leave nothing left. How do you know God doesn't want you to eliminate your enemy and leave nothing left? Okay? And you're like, okay, I read the text. It's plain. I'm going to eliminate him. I may not kill him because I don't want to go to jail, but I'm making sure this joker gets fired. He'll never find another job, ever, when I get through with him. Before you make that decision, I want to encourage you to go read the story of Jesus with the Pharisees and the Sadducees. Okay? How does he treat the people who want to murder him? How does he respond to them? Okay? And there's examples of it. Okay? You know, when he goes and talks to them, let me see if I have it in my notes. And I don't. I do remember reading it, but they want to kill him. He raises Lazarus from the dead, and they are just undone. And from the time he raises Lazarus from the dead, they plot to kill Lazarus again and Jesus. And you know, he meets them and he says, why are you trying to kill me? Hits them directly. Why are you trying to kill me? What have I done? He speaks to them. He doesn't excuse away their sin. He doesn't politic. Very direct. And he goes in the same way you killed the prophets. Hold them accountable. Wow. Which way should you follow? Do you do Samuel, who chopped up the king? Or do you do Jesus? Okay. I'm telling you today, in the time after Christ, you do Jesus. You do Jesus. I don't understand exactly why God told Samuel that. And actually, I do, because the text, if you kept reading in the text, you'd understand that these people had killed the weak and the widows and the powerless of Israel. They had attacked them from the back. And they were still those same kind of raiders. Right now, they were just a little afraid. And they were never going to allow Israel peace because they had made a vow to eliminate them. And we see what happens in Esther. Because they left some of them alive, they tried to kill the Jews centuries later. God was trying to protect. He didn't have another option. Okay? But we don't have that foresight. But Jesus is a new time for us. Jesus is like, deal with the problem. Don't excuse the sin. But in the end, Jesus doesn't go chopping up people. He doesn't do that. Your job as a Christian, if we look at the life of Christ, takes us right back to Luke and the Sermon on the Mount. Because what if you lose your job? Well, you might. And Jesus' words are very instructive in Luke chapter 5. Or it's Matthew chapter 5. It is also in Luke, but in Matthew chapter 5. Because it says, 5 verse 9, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. Well, what happened to the Son of God? Let's just be real. He got crucified. He had an amazing life, and he touched a lot of people. He brought a lot of peace to their hearts and to their homes. He healed their bodies. But in the end, he died. But then he goes on. They get called the sons of God. And blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. So if you follow the life of Christ, not the life of Saul, not even the life of Samuel, if you follow the life of Christ, you receive the kingdom of heaven, not a kingdom here. What's the difference between us and Saul? Saul was building a kingdom here. God is trying to build a kingdom in heaven and in your heart. He's not trying to change the world externally. That didn't work. Israel just became racist and biased and nationalistic and prejudiced. Not really racist, but prejudiced and insular. Because they were trying to build a kingdom. And Jesus said to Pilate, my kingdom is not of this world. In another place, he says, the kingdom of God is within you. He's like, I'm dealing with the root now. I'm not worried about the leaves. I'm dealing with the root, which is, I need to write my love on your hearts. How do I do that? I've got to show you that I love you. I've got to live a life that says I love you and that I lay my life down for you while, as Paul says, you were yet enemies. So as followers of Christ, while someone is your enemy, be a peacemaker. Don't have to cover their sin. Hold them accountable. Speak to them. Go to them. In prayer and in love, because your goal is, by the way, not to judge them. Your goal is to give God an opportunity to convert them. As a Christian, your job, this is hardcore, your job is to convert them, not to get a paycheck. And guess what? All you do is give them an opportunity for the Holy Spirit who does the converting. You're just trying to get a little light in their darkness so the Holy Spirit can blow it open and change their whole life. That's our job. All the other stuff just pays our bills. And Christ says, look at my life. This is the rule of interpretation for a Christian. And just in case you think that I'm making this up, there's numerous examples I can give you. Jesus himself says in Matthew chapter 5, verse 21, he says, you have heard that it was said to those of old, you shall not murder. Verse 22, but I say to you, whoever is angry with his brother without a cause shall be in danger of judgment. You have heard. Then, this is what we did. God had a plan then. He has to make a physical space to bring a physical Messiah into the world. Once he brings the physical Messiah, whom we call Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, once he brings the physical Messiah, he says, now I'm working on people's hearts. I'm not worried about changing the world on the outside. He says, that world is passing away anyways. But if I get to their hearts, there can be a little heaven wherever that one person goes. There could be a little heaven where 10 of those people are gathered together. But notice, because he says this, when Jesus prays for his disciples in the end, he says, I don't pray that you take them out of the world. I pray that you keep them while they're in the world. And then if you look at the Beatitudes, he says, you are the salt of the earth. You are a city on a hill. Your love is what changes the world. It's what gives God an opportunity to convert his enemies, to convert your enemies. And this is how we must interpret Scripture, through the life of Christ, through the lens of Jesus' life, through the lens of Jesus' words. It's like you took off your glasses and you put Jesus on. Okay? You don't understand the text. Pray and ask God to show you, where is a principle that I can find in Jesus' life so that I know how to understand my circumstance? We spend a lot of time on Revelation. We spend a lot of time on Daniel, and Daniel's amazing. Revelation is amazing. But do you know, they didn't have that in the New Testament, and we keep trying to go back, and we want New Testament Holy Spirit, right? We want the power of those New Testament Christians so we can go boldly speak the words of Christ. And so we read Daniel, and we read Revelation, and we're wrong. If you want to speak boldly the words of Christ, you want to speak boldly, live boldly for Christ, you better go spend more time with Christ. You better dig into the Gospels, read those words in red. Spend time knowing who he is. Who did he show himself to be? The gospel writers picked the stories that were the strongest, that really impressed their minds, because John says there would have been so many stories, it would have filled a million books because of what he did in a short 33 years. So they took out the things that were most applicable, and they gave them to us through the guidance of the Holy Spirit. And just in case, and then Jesus still, if you go to Luke, come with me to Luke chapter 24. Luke chapter 24, verse 27. Actually, let's go before that. This is the road to Emmaus. And it's so interesting. There's two disciples walking, and they're conversing, and it says in verse 15, chapter 24, verse 15, so it was while they conversed and reasoned that Jesus himself drew near and went with them, but their eyes were restrained, so they didn't know him. And he says, what kind of conversation are you having as you walk and are sad? And once Cleopas says, are you a stranger in Jerusalem? Don't you know what happened these days? And he says to them, what things? And so they tell him all the things concerning Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how the chief priests and our rulers delivered him to be condemned to death and crucified him. And they said, but we were hoping he was going to redeem Israel. Indeed, all this today is the third day since these things happened. Then he says, certain women astonished us. They tell him all the story. And this is verse 25. Then he said to them, O foolish ones and slow of heart to believe in all the prophets have spoken. Ought not the Christ to have suffered these things to enter into his glory? And in verse 27, he says, and beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded to them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. They couldn't understand before because they couldn't see him in the scriptures. So they are looking for Israel to be redeemed on earth because they're not looking through the life of Christ. Everything about his life said, I didn't come for a kingdom on earth. He hung out with the poor. He hung out with diseased people, okay? He let weak people with bad reputations wash his feet and listen to him speak. That is not the person who's courting political office and trying to change the government. That's not how you change the government, okay? He wasn't networking with the Pharisees. No, he was hanging out with the powerless. He was going to their weddings, and even at the wedding, did you ever notice in the wedding he's in the back with the servants, or was I the only person who missed this? His mom's in the back, he's in the back, he's not partying with everybody else, they're in the back with the servants. How do you think he knew they didn't have any more wine? He's helping. I love that. He's a servant all the time. And so for them to understand that little example of the riding in the town humble and on a donkey was to show that his kingdom was different. His priorities are different. But the only way we can understand how to put his priorities and make them our priorities as we read scripture is we must look at the scriptures and realize they all talk about him. The prophecies, they point to him, which means we have to constantly go take those scriptures and then look at his life. And that's how we can understand the scripture. Look at 24, verses 44, because he says this again. That's with one small group. Then in verse 44, in the same chapter of Luke 24, 44, he said to them, these are the words which I spoke to you while I was still with you, that all things must be fulfilled, which were written in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms. He makes it very clear. All of the corpus of the Hebrew scriptures, the Old Testament, that's the Bible they had. All of that they need to read through him, his life. And it says in 45, and he opened their understanding that they might comprehend the scriptures. Once they could see Jesus in the other scriptures, then they could understand what was happening. If you want to understand what is happening in Daniel, you want to understand what is happening in Revelation, you want to understand what's happening in Genesis, you're constantly going to have to go back to the life of Jesus. And what I would encourage you is to spend time, when you read his words, look at his life. And it's been really enriching for me. I hope my students aren't too bored. But to see him, and I realized that my understanding is really opening towards other people. And I'm going to give you this example. I was talking to Ricky about this. We were talking in the car. And I read this terrible article I thought it was terrible. It was a well-written article, but the topic was rather sad. They're talking about people who, they've decided marriage is not for just two people, it's for three or four people. And they all hang out together. And I just thought, wow, that just is crazy. And it's kind of gross. And this was my personal reaction to it. They have a right to live their life however they wish to. God's given them that option, okay? And my first inclination is like, no, don't do that, right? That's a control on them. God has made them free. And they were talking about how they wanted acceptance. And there was one of the men in one of the relationships, polygamy or whatever it's called, relationships, was saying how, you know, he was made like this. And I was like, you were made to just be with everybody? I'm sharing with you my honest reactions, but he was made like this. And it kind of hit me And I thought back on what I'd been studying. No, you weren't made like this. You were made to be perfect. You were made to be loyal and true and honest. But because of sin, you are a slave to your desires. And suddenly I felt, instead of my like, ugh. And even in the article, they talk about how people were saying to them, we hate your lifestyle, but we love you. And they said, we reject it. That means you hate us. And I was like, some of them got some Christian family in there. That's what their Christian friends have said. I love you, but I hate your lifestyle. And because that's the best thing sometimes we know to say. And this is kind of what hit me, is I don't know what your lifestyle is. For all I know, they might be happy living in varying forms of what the Bible calls as sin. But I felt sympathy because I thought he's enslaved to his desires and he needs Jesus so that he can realize he's accepted and he doesn't have to do things that will cause himself harm and then justify those things. I don't need to condemn his lifestyle. The whole world does. His own heart does. All I need, all he's looking for truly is acceptance and peace. And he's hoping if he gives in to all of these things that are even hurting the people he cares about, he's just gonna, it's gonna be okay. It's never gonna be okay. But the only way it's ever gonna be okay is if he comes to God and lets Jesus come in his heart. It's outside from me. Outside from you, outside from his family, and let Jesus share with him his great love for him, and let Jesus work in his heart so that he even wants to choose a different way of living. And all I can do if I meet someone like that is hopefully give Jesus an opportunity to step in and write his love on there, on his heart. I only think that because I spent time reading in the Word. And so now, if I come into a situation, I really start thinking, you know, that's your life. But you need to meet Jesus. Let's talk about Jesus. Let's talk about Jesus with your whole polyandry family, or whatever it's called. It's a family. Let's talk about Jesus. Let's talk about love. How do I show you the love? Maybe Jesus can give me some power to heal some brokenness in their life. And then they'll go to God on their own. I've done my job. That's the Jesus of the New Testament as a Christian, what we are called to do, to be salt of the earth, to be a city on a hill. And that's how we understand Scripture. And there are other principles of understanding Scripture. But first, the basic principle as a Christian that I want you to walk away with today. If you want to understand Revelation, you want to understand Daniel, you want to understand Genesis, you want to understand the Psalms, you make sure that you understand Jesus in the book of John, Jesus in the book of Matthew, Jesus in the book of Luke, Jesus in the book of Mark. Start there. And get your arms all wrapped up in Jesus and start having those texts just pop in your head. And Jesus said this, and Jesus did this. And this reminds me of the parable of this. Let those come into your mind and fill your soul. Let's pray. Father in heaven, you're so awesome. While we were yet sinners, you were thinking on us. You had a plan from the foundation of the earth to save us from choices we didn't even understand, from consequences we couldn't even figure out. And you sent Jesus to show us your love, your mercy, your acceptance, and your power to change us, but still help us be us. Lord, we thank you for setting us free from the power of sin so that we could truly love each other. Be kind and gracious and merciful, and not be fearful and judgmental and angry and controlling. Lord, we ask for more of your Holy Spirit. I ask that you fill us up to the brim so that your grace, your kindness would just be in us and would pour out of us in the world, and so that there would be more peace in people's hearts, so that when you come, and you will come soon, that our heart would match the kingdom of heaven that we see, and we would go home. In Jesus' name I pray.